London-based lawyer Anand Dubey informed his client Nirav Modi of the bitter truth.
Nirav, they have tracked you down. It's best that you turn yourself in.
48-year-old diamond merchant Nirav had been on the run since over a year when the $2 billion or 14,336 crore Punjab National Bank scam broke. See Bisbo's story on how the scam was done through fake LOUs. Escaping first to New York, he was tracked down to his $5 million penthouse on 50 Riverside Boulevard. Using a golden British visa issued to him just after the scam broke in early March 2018, he then scurried away to Belgium from where he reached London. Thinking he was safe there, he blatantly opened a diamond showroom in Old Bond Street and rented an apartment in central London. But the London landlord, aware of his dodgy reputation for payment, had him vacate. Worried, he went to live in faraway Manchester and even Cairo, waiting for things to cool down. By this time it was July 2018 and India had already raised an extradition request with the British government, but UK authorities were still to act on it. Seeing that India's focus was still on Vijay Mallya's extradition, see Bisbo's two stories. Nirav once again moved to London, this time discreetly. In May 2018, he opened a business at the address of his CA, Dattani Chartered Accountants, calling his company Diamond Holdings. Then in the 33-storied Centrepoint Apartments, just off Oxford Street in central London, where rents are £15,000 plus per month, he went to live on the 29th floor of his two 3-bedroom luxury homes he had bought in January 2018, only a month before the scam broke. Apartments 5 and 42 both were purchased Benami in the name of a Richard Betty, paid for in cash £7.95 million for each of them. It was here that Mick Brown, a reporter from the Daily Telegraph, tracked him down.
Every afternoon at around 3 p.m, Nirav Modi takes his dog out for a walk.
After trailing and photographing him for 3 days, finding out where he lived and getting familiar with his routine, he confronted him with questions.
Mr. Modi, you're the subject of an extradition treaty, extradition application. How long do you intend to stay in England, Mr. Modi? Are you still trading in diamonds, Mr. Modi?
To which every answer with a sheepish smile and a twinkle in his eyes was,
"No comment, no comment."
The video went viral and it front page in India's media.
Nirav cracked down in London wearing ostrich jacket worth £12,000.
Within hours, the resultant uproar forced UK Home Secretary Sajid Javid to certify India's long pending extradition request, leading to an automatic arrest warrant. With nowhere to run, his lawyer advised him,
"Nirav, before they arrest you, it's best that you turn yourself in."
Dubey of Boutique Law was speaking from experience. He had done the same with Vijay Mallya in April 2017. After Mallya had voluntarily turned himself in, there had been no handcuffs and Mallya was simply driven to court in a police car, posted bail and went back home the very same day. So they decided to take an appointment with a central London police station for the Monday after next, 25th March.
"Let's do it at 9 a.m. so we can post bail the same day. Keep the documents ready."
With the plan finalized, Nirav set out to do one last thing before hunkering down for his last few days on the run. The next day, he went to Metro Bank in Holborn area of central London.
"I need to open a bank account for my company."
The bank executive recognized him.
"Yes, sure. Can you please wait while I get all the papers processed? Thank you."
And instead, called the police.
"You have an arrest warrant out for Mr. Modi from India, right? Well, yes, he is sitting right here at our bank."
Meanwhile in India, the Economic Offences Wing and Enforcement Directorate were seizing his assets left, right and centre. His 30,000 square foot bungalow Rupanya in Alibag of Mumbai was stripped bare and then dynamited after it was declared illegal for coastal zone violation. 68 paintings were e-auctioned in March on saffronmart.com for $9 million or 55 crore, a first for the Income Tax Department to use a professional auction house. 13 cars, including a Rolls-Royce Ghost, a Porsche Panamera and two Mercedes-Benzes were also e-auctioned. A second supplementary charge sheet was filed a year later against 17 companies and 10 individuals, this time including his wife Ami, under Prevention of Money Laundering Act for illegally buying a flat in London. The details of how the 14,336 crore or $2 billion, almost half of which was diverted to 17 shell companies in Hong Kong, Dubai and the US. Some of the money was used for buying personal property, like the two flats near Central Park, New York for $25 million and $5 million or 215 crore. Setting up a new line of jewelry stores in the US by buying out America's oldest diamond company, Bailey, Bank & Biddle for $47 million, 327 crore. And the cheek of it, repaying foreign banks by swindling an Indian bank to the tune of $110 million or 800 crore. This is the precise manner in which he transferred money to buy assets in the US, from Punjab National Bank India to Fine Classics FZE Dubai owned by sister Purvi, onto Amicorp Bank & Trust Barbados into an account owned by Purvi, then into HSBC New York into Ami Modi's account, then to Bank of Singapore in Singapore, Purvi's account, into Commonwealth Trust owned by the Modi family, onto Ithaca Trust USA, whose beneficiary is Ami Modi and her children, which was finally used to buy property and jewelry in the US. Some of the money was transferred into two offshore companies in 2017, Ilkas Global Holdings Limited Mauritius and Progressive Investments Limited Cyprus, from where Nirav had planned to round-trip the money into his flagship Firestar India, showing it as foreign investment or FDI, and then list it on the Bombay Stock Exchange at a high price. Many of these assets in Hong Kong, Switzerland, Singapore, UK, USA and the UAE worth $267 million or 1,873 crore have been traced and provisionally attached by the ED. Interestingly, one of these properties is an apartment which the CEO of his US company Mihir Bansali had bought from Punjab National Bank funds for 7.1 million or 50 crore, less than a year before the scam broke. He sold this to his wife Rakhi for just $10, only 2 days after Nirav's Firestar US filed for bankruptcy protection in a bid to show zero assets. Bansali managed all the 17 shell companies run by Nirav and used a server software that automatically deleted everything and prevented recovery. However, India's Cybercrime Bureau managed to recover a master spreadsheet of the fraudulent LOUs taken from Punjab National Bank. Another co-accused, Nirav's uncle Mehul Choksi, sits free in Antigua despite a pending extradition request by the Indian government. Back in London, a surprise Nirav was arrested on a Friday and had to spend the weekend in custody at the local police station. Denied bail the following week, he was sent to Wandsworth prison, where he remains. For his second bail hearing, CBI and ED teams flew from India into London to assist the UK Crown Prosecution Service, CPS's Toby Cadman, in opposing Nirav's bail. Their star witness Ashish Lad, former director of one of Nirav's group companies, revealed in a sworn affidavit in Westminster Magistrate's Court,
"Nirav had kept 12 of us in captivity in Cairo."
According to allegations made by him, Nirav tricked 12 of his employees into leaving Dubai.
"I will give you capital to start businesses in Cairo, but don't give any statements against me."
Once they reached there, however, he kept them locked up in a house from April to June 2018. According to Ashish, Nirav even threatened him.
"I'm warning you, if you reveal anything, I will kill you."
By threatening a witness, Nirav's case is now no more limited to financial fraud. Opposing bail, the prosecution argued he was a flight risk as he had plans to disappear.
"Your Honor, he paid $200,000 and applied for a visa to the Pacific island of Vanuatu but was denied."
Where it was rumored he had planned to undergo plastic surgery to change his look completely and vanish. At Nirav's third bail hearing, lawyer Claire Montgomery desperately played her last card.
"We are ready to give £2 million as bail surety, wear an electronic tag and remain under house arrest."
But with Nirav owning two passports, Indian and British, and multiple residency cards of Hong Kong, Singapore and the UAE, UK Magistrate Emma Arbuthnot was unconvinced that he had sufficient social ties to remain in the UK.
"Bail denied. £1 million is not substantial security where £1 billion has been lost."
Incidentally, Arbuthnot is the same judge that ordered Vijay Mallya's extradition and caused quite a laugh when...
"Which part of India is Nirav likely to be held in?"
"In Mumbai."
"Will Nirav and Mallya share a cell if they're extradited?" I'm getting a sense of deja vu.
As if on cue, the bankruptcy court in US charged Nirav under RICO, Racketeering Influence and Corruption Organization Act, a law used to target the Chicago Mafia Gambino family. Nirav could now be convicted in the US to a maximum prison term of 20 years for purposefully defrauding Punjab National Bank. Cornered in the US and the UK, he gets ready to face the music. Nirav Modi's successful extradition will serve as a warning to the others that there is no place to run and hide. Bisbo's Limerick. Nirav Modi is in a hot soup. He ran away to London thinking he's flown the coop. But the long arm of the law unearthed his flaw. Now he sits behind bars. No one else he can dupe.
Subscribe to Bisbo's channel and be sure to click on the bell icon. Be the first to know when Bisbo releases a new video.